Having done that, we will move over to some very preliminary issues with compressible flows. Okay? So, compressible flows have their own challenges. For example, shocks. Okay? So how do you deal with representing shocks? So, we are most of the time we would be using continuous functions, but then at least in a inviscid framework, shocks lead to discontinuous solutions. So, how do you represent discontinuous solutions using continuous variables, and what kind of problems it poses? How do you capture shocks? So, those are some of the challenges we will try to address in this part of the course. Of course, it will be rather brief. What we will realize is that the traditional Galerkin method, which works very nicely for heat conduction problems, is not going to work for flow problems, both for incompressible and compressible flows. So, we will have to deal with some new kinds of framework, which are called the Petrov-Galerkin methods. Okay, so we'll look at them. I don't want to harp on it right now, but when the time comes, then we'll see that these are very clever modifications to the Galerkin method to make them work. Okay, so those of you who are familiar with upwinding in finite difference methods, you will realize that if you use a staggered grid for solving your equations, that works better than grids where the pressure and velocity are not staggered. So, these kind of methods actually allow us to do similar things in the framework of finite elements. I am also going to expose you to certain special topics, time permitting. For example, how do you implement these in the framework of high performance computing? So if you use your standard algorithms on sequential computers versus if you had to implement these methods on parallel computers or parallel vector computers for large scale computing, then what is it that you should keep in mind? What are the issues that come up when you do mesh generation or grid generation? And a little bit exposure to graphics and visualization. Essentially, what are the tools that one needs to practice good CFD to be able to come up with meaningful solution? Many of these special topics I am hoping would be covered actually by you through your term papers. So, the idea is that some of you will get together in a group, study maybe one aspect of a topic and then present it to the rest of the class, and thereby all of us would learn something new, more than what is in the lecture material. So, that I think would be a good way to look at special topics. I of course will assist you in choosing the material to make these presentation in the special topics. Okay, a little bit about the recommended textbooks or the reference books that we will follow in this course. So, the first few lectures where I talk about the finite difference methods, very simple finite difference methods, that could be found in several books. For example, by Professor Krasik, this is a very classical book, Advanced Engineering Math. Many of you must have glanced through it or followed it in your first courses in math. So, it has a very good chapter on numerical math, and I am going to use this to motivate some very simple topics in finite differences. The bulk of the course would actually be from this book. So, we will be following the second book here listed in this list as almost like a textbook. So, Professor Hughes has been a father figure in introducing finite element analysis and fluid flows, and this book is very well written. It starts from the very basics and builds up the method. So, you can in one single book you can find the finite element method itself in space, and then how do you do discretization in time, ideas of stability, convergence, and how to choose elements, approximations for fluid mechanics. So this book has several versions, but the latest one is from the Dover Publications. So you should be able to find a copy of this. I strongly encourage you to get a copy of this book, and it would help you even later when you want to use the method. The third book is by Professor Fletcher with a very general title, Computational Fluid Dynamics. Again, it's a good reference book. Similarly, number four is a book by Professor Charles Hirsch, which builds up more on finite difference, finite volume kind of methods, both for internal and external flows. We'll use this as a reference book. In fact, it's a little bit easy reading compared to the book by Professor Hughes. So maybe if some of you find this going a little bit tough, you can first maybe read a little bit from Professor Hirsch's book and then go back to the book by Professor Hughes. This book over here is again fairly easy to read, by Furziger and Parikh, Computational Methods for Fluid Dynamics, very, very easy reading. And in fact, I like this book because it gives you a very nice overview of the various methods. But I would suggest this is more like a reference book, and it would give you a very nice overview of the various methods. This book number six is a classic again. In fact, when I was an undergraduate student and I took my first course in CFD, then in fact I was taught from this book, okay, by Professor Anderson. So this is more on finite difference methods, and it again builds the topic in a very nice manner, starting from the basics. Again, very easy to read. So some of you may want to look at this book as well. This is a more recent book, okay? I mean, recent in the sense almost a decade old, and I like this book very much. So this is, as you can see, the title itself says Finite Element Method for Flow Problems, and Professor Donia and Huerta, they again start from the very basics and build up a finite element method and all its nuances to address fluid flow. In fact, we will use this book towards the topic where we move to fluid flow problems. So one of the treatments that I really enjoy in this book is how they look at convection driven problems and how to design a upwinding method for a convection problem. So we'll specially use this book for that part of the course. In addition to this book, there are many other books available over the internet in our central library, or you may have personal copies. This Professor Zinkevich, Professor Reddy, Professor Gresho has an extremely good book on incompressible flows. Professor Klaas Johnson has a nice book on finite element analysis. And in addition, once in a while I will refer to journal articles, and if you come across any and you would like to point them to the class, you are free to do that. So we'll have these various forums on the portal, which I will inform you as we move along in the course. So that's about it for the reference material and the textbook in this course. I wanted to say a few things about the grades and the policies in this course. You know, I am very aware that this is an elective course. So this is not a course which you are supposed to take as a mandatory course, or you were forced to take it. So I am very aware that you took it because you actually want to, you have some interest in the course, and it's purely for learning. But nevertheless, there will be some policies for evaluating you and giving you a grade at the end. So just to lay out things a little bit more explicitly, I thought I will highlight the policies. So I encourage you to go through these lectures. I know online teaching can be a little bit tricky, and you may not find the lectures as interesting as you would have otherwise found when we could meet face to face. My apologies for that, but I hope we can make up for that by you contacted me for discussions, either when we have live discussion hours, or feel free to contact me otherwise, either through email or phone, and we'll try to do the best we can. We can also use the forum for discussions, so that others who may have similar questions but did not have the courage to ask can also go through that material. Okay. So I strongly encourage that you attend the online discussions and the sessions in addition to the lectures. This is primarily because sometimes, you know, in this kind of a course, people would come up with some issues that not all of us may have thought through earlier, and they could benefit us. And also in these sessions, I may make some announcements, and I would expect that you would be responsible for any announcement that I make. Okay, there will be a series of home assignments, and they will be in modules, so that they contribute to a final project. So just to give you an example, suppose the target was to be able to make you feel that you can solve flow past a body by the end of the course. So that would require, for example, a grid generation. Then that would require you the ability to show that you can solve AX equal to B, a system of algebraic equations, that you can carry out numerical integration. You can come up with a module to write finite element functions and their derivatives. So the plan is that I would work them out as assignments, and then later you can just use these modules which you would have from earlier assignments and make them into a final project. Okay. So therefore, my suggestion is that when I give you a homework assignment, please try to do it in a manner that it is modular. Okay. That you should be able, so suppose I ask you to solve, to demonstrate that you can solve AX equal to B. The idea is that you should be able to use this later when you do your project, and you can call that as a subroutine. Similarly, if you do numerical integration, then you should be able to call that module and give it any function that you would like, and this subroutine should be able to integrate that. Okay. I get this question quite often in the earlier versions of the course that I have taught, that what is the programming language that I recommend. So I will give you the answer that I usually give, that I have no recommendations or preferences. You please use whichever programming language you are comfortable with. Those of you who use Fortran, we are okay with that. If you want to use C, or if you want to use C++ or Java, anything that you desire is okay. I mean, this is a course on the finite element method and not as such on a programming language. So I am not going to be able to test you on a programming language. That's not the intent of this course. But those of you who are scared of programming, you have two options. A, you please get used to programming. In fact, you can use MATLAB. MATLAB is hardly any programming. It is simply just writing some scripts. Or if you really feel scared, then you might have to drop this course. Okay. You know, practicing numerics is more like practicing cooking. You cannot say you are a good cook, but you only know the recipes. Okay, you cannot indulge in cooking. So in a course which pushes numerical methods, I think it is only fair that you implement those methods, and that would certainly involve some programming. Okay. You can even use different languages as you move along if you are comfortable with that. So you could, for example, do some modules in Fortran, some others in C, and then of course these languages allow calling subroutines in different languages and integrating them. I'm not saying you should, but should you feel the need to do that, I think that's perfectly acceptable. Point number four, I already alluded to this. This is actually a way that I have been enjoying teaching this course. So, you know, there are two aspects of the way you can learn in a course. One is the material that I push in the class, and the other is that actually through self-learning, and we leverage that to teach the rest of the class. So my expectation is that each one of you will do a short term paper, and you will choose a certain topic. In fact, I can even float a list of suggested topics, but I really look forward to innovation from you, creativity from you. You can form groups of 3 to 5 students, depending on the number of students who register for this course. I don't think I would like to have more than 12 to 15 groups, because that becomes too many. So we'll decide on the number of persons who form the group, and each group can pick a certain topic. The topics could be, you know, like isogeometric analysis, which is really using splines or some such innovative ways to represent surfaces, or maybe meshless methods or discontinuous Galerkin methods, or for example large eddy simulation, fluid structure interactions, high speed chemistry, and so on. So you would choose a topic, and of course these topics are very general, so I cannot expect you that you would know everything about meshless method by choosing this topic and doing a project. So first is to choose a topic and then kind of decide what is the aspect of meshless method that you would look at. Are you going to talk about the overview of what a meshless method is compared to a method which uses a mesh, or you are interested in its application to a certain problem? So there would be some specificity in the project that you choose, and that would be determined by the material that you would read for it. So I don't expect you to write programs or do research on these topics. Essentially it's more about literature survey, reading them and then presenting it to the class so that it is comprehensible to everyone. So you would choose a topic, and you would choose the literature that you would read, and discuss it with me, and once we agree on it, then I will give you some time. You can prepare your presentations, and we can meet and look at the various presentations on these topics. So it's summarized here that you will choose a topic, make a list of papers to explore it, and the topic as well as the literature that you plan must be finalized and okayed by me by a mutually agreed deadline. This is very important, and I think it's fair that I tell you why I do this. Many a times, because this is something extra, a term paper, it is very tempting to push it to the very end and then hurry up just a little bit before the date of presentation and put things together. Okay? I want to avoid that. So by implementing this kind of scenario, I think I will end up forcing you to look at these topics well in advance and plan your presentations. As I said, there will be homeworks, and I would expect you to submit your homeworks in time. It is also easy for me to arrange for the logistics in terms of evaluating them. And I would, because they add up to the final project, so it is only fair that to be able to pass the course, you have to submit all the assignments. If you submit them by the deadline, you get credit for it, but if you do not, then you don't get any credit for it and you still have to submit the assignment. So I strongly encourage you to respect the deadlines and submit the assignments. This being an elective course and it has these very diverse topics, so I strongly encourage you to discuss the concepts amongst yourselves, either privately or through the forum that this course will use, possibly on Mookit. But you know, I would still like that do not collaborate on the assignments. These you should do on your own, and they would in fact help you in the examinations that will be conducted. So there will be two examinations, a midterm exam, so that's the weightage is about 20%, and then a final exam at the end of the semester, that's about 35%, and then a lot of weightage is given to the assignments and projects. So I have not broken up this 45% into how many assignments and how many you know, credits for the term paper. So we'll do that as we move along. But you can see there's a substantial weightage on actually doing things and not just understanding what is given in the class and spitting it out in the exam. One minor point that I will not be able to give you a makeup exam if you miss the midterm, even for bona fide reasons. So if you just skip if the midterm exam for no reason, then of course you lose all credit for it. But suppose in the unfortunate event of any one of you falling sick, then with appropriate certification, I should be able to prorate your score for the midterm from the other scores. So that's about it as far as the course policies are concerned. I hope we have a very enjoyable semester and we can discuss this in one of the discussion hours. Thank you very much.